Taking a perovskite solar cell from the lab scale to commercial application is a monumental task. Just ask any researcher currently working on the scale-up of tandem solar cells. So today we will be discussing the challenges in upscaling perovskite solar cells and how to use simulation to try to overcome them. So let's get to it. Hello and welcome to Fluxim Science Shorts with me, Dr. Antonio Cabasvidani. Before we get started, make sure you subscribe, like, and hit that notification button. Thin-film photovoltaic solar cells, such as perovskites and organic types, are perfect for large area flexible applications. However, with the increase of the device area, the total device resistance increases, negatively impacting the fill factor. The electrical resistance of a solar cell device increases with the length of the device, but decreases with the width. That means that if you break down the solar cell into several elongated slices and interconnect them, you can create a large area solar cell, while keeping the resistance low. This is the concept behind the monolithic module design. The active area of the solar cell is divided into narrow and elongated strips with interconnection gaps. These strips are isolated subcells connected to one another through the top and bottom electrodes. The narrower the subcells, the lower the overall resistance becomes, leading to an improved fill factor. In essence, we are optimizing performance one cell at a time. But as always, there's a catch. The interconnection gap is a dead area, which reduces the total active area. The interconnection is a combination of three scribing lines, P1, P2, and P3. They separate the TCO, the photoactive layer, and the contact between consecutive subcells. The optimization of the design for the highest device efficiency possible requires expensive and time-consuming trial and error experiments in the laboratory. You can optimize a solar module through simulation software to save time and money. A software ideal for simulating the scale-up must take into account the transport of charges in the three dimensions, while providing a good approximation of the large area performance starting from measured or simulated lab-scale device JV curves. However, a full three-dimensional simulation of the whole device can be computationally demanding and slow. A more efficient approach mimics the 3D transport by splitting simulation in 2D and 1D simulations. The 2D simulation describes the current flow in the electrodes, while the 1D simulation couples the two electrodes through the provided JV curve. The simulation software Laoss from Fluxim solves the 2D simulation of the electrodes with a finite element method, and it allows to evaluate how the key parameters of the solar cell scale with a module layout and its dimensions. Using Laoss, we can predict the optimal subcell area for maximizing power output. Laoss predicts the JV characteristics of the large area module based on experimentally determined JV of lab-scale devices. To speed up this process, we have developed a feature in Laoss called Full Module Handling. This feature lets us simulate various module sizes, easing the design process. We define the subcell area using the module's dimensions, gap size, and cell count. It's worth noting that the simulation assumes the subcells have lossless interconnections, which might overestimate the photovoltaic key figures like current and voltage. We started by considering a module height of 50 mm and a module width of 41 mm. The interconnection width is fixed at 2 mm, while the amount of subcells varies from 1 to 10. We use the experimental JV curves provided by the University of Surrey of a lab-scale slot dye-coated perovskite solar cell to perform the scale-up prediction, which you can see here. We can perform the same prediction using the actual module design, for which we can define the width and sheet resistance of each individual scribing line. There's a good agreement between the currents of the two simulations, so the full module handling provides a reasonable approximation of the real module design. Now that we have assessed the precision of the full module handling, we can analyze the progress further with the scale-up prediction. Considering the experimental JV curve we used as input, the maximum power output is obtained with four subcells. With more subcells, the voltage increases linearly, but the current sharply decreases with the total active area. The fill factor trend mirrors the current and is highest with 10 subcells because of the reduced total resistance. With less than four subcells, the power output decreases due to increasing total resistance. Let's talk about the interconnection gap's influence. This dead area must be minimized to minimize electrical losses and maximize the mini module's power output. As shown in this plot, With a narrower gap, the maximum power output is obtained for a large number of subcells. By reducing the gap size, the fill factor experiences a decrease due to a slight increase in total resistance associated with expanded active area. However, we should take a look also at the geometrical fill factor, GFF. It represents the proportion of active area to the total module area, or in other words, it indicates how effective is the module geometry in exploiting the total area. More subcells lead to lower GFF values, which can be largely compensated by minimizing the width of the interconnection gap. As a result, the solar panel has the potential to generate more electricity overall. The sheet resistance of the transparent conductive oxide also directly influences the fill factor. High sheet resistance can increase series resistance within the cell, reducing the fill factor and thus the overall efficiency. Here we show the maximum power output with an increasing number of subcells and sheet resistance of 15, 10 and 5 ohm over square. A lower sheet resistance reduces the total series resistance of the cell, improves the squareness of the JV curve, hence the power at MPP and the FF increase. So we have two factors to consider, sheet resistance and the gap width, to maximize the power output, and both contribute differently. This graph presents a compelling look at power density losses, given different gap width and sheet resistance values, compared to a lab-scale solar cell. Interestingly, for a module with a gap width of 2 mm and a sheet resistance of 15 ohm over square, the loss in power density surges to over 20% compared to the lab-scale cell. The steep curve of loss isn't just a visual representation. It carries a powerful insight. It tells us that decreasing the dead area in a module with a high sheet resistance is a more effective approach than simply lowering the sheet resistance in a module with a smaller dead area. This suggests we need to consider multiple factors in optimizing solar cell performance. In conclusion, in this video we've discussed how the monolithic module design introduces a dead area to separate the photoactive area into multiple subcells of smaller areas. This design reduces the resistance but also decreases the current. The highest power output requires optimizing the number of subcells and the width of the dead area to minimize resistance and maximize current. This optimization is not universal and depends on many parameters, including the PV stack, electrode resistance, total module area, interconnection width, and potentially others. In a previous blog post, we also analyzed an alternative route to decrease the sheet resistance of the TCO for large area devices, which requires the addition of conductive metal grids on top of the TCO. It is a very effective but also rather expensive solution, while still reducing the available active area. Do you know other methods to achieve high performance in large area photovoltaic devices that you want us to discuss? Let us know in the comments below. Thank you for joining us in this exploration of upscaling perovskite solar cells using simulation. We hope you find it insightful. For more detailed simulations, be sure to check out the Laoss software. Until next time!